محمد وآل محمد.
رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين ولعنة الله الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم بمصابنا بأبي عبد الله الحسين عليه الصلاة والسلام. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We did state that today we will be going towards the application of what we have been talking about so far and narrowing it down much further than what we have been doing so far. We have been discussing theory and now we need to come to how it affects us. But tonight being such a grand night, and we do want to spend a considerable amount of time talking about the hero, the one that we will venerate on this grand night and whose martyrdom we will be reciting. And hence, due to the shortage of time, we may again just look at the broad aspects of this theory and come to the application tomorrow in the rightest sense. Now, we stated that wilaya is that agency that refashions the horizontal scheme as one of its aspects and its functions. We stated that the absence of wilaya, the collective intellect will be within the place of wilaya. No single individual, no single man can sit in the place or occupy the seat of Muhammad or the descendants of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam alayhi wa salatu wa salam. Leave aside ordinary man. If you were to put 1,000 and 1,000,000 Einstein together, they cannot occupy that seat. It is a seat that can only be occupied in the absence of the 12th Imam by the collective intellect, benefiting from the collective experience and in the process of trial and error. Now, we stated that what is sacred is that vertical relationship. We are drowning within Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through self-directedness towards that focal point. The community adds to the individual adds to the community, together they evolve. The evolutionary cycle brings about plurality and relativity. Plurality at the horizontal level, relativity and plurality at the horizontal level, and relativity in the vertical progressive trend. Now, it is here that we ask a very simple question as we resume our talks, that what was the point in the occultation of the 12th Imam Salamullah Alayh? Think about this very, very carefully. The Shias maintained centrality of wilaya. I ask a very simple question, then why did the Imam go into occultation? Especially given that the major part of evolution occurs and progression occurs after the occultation of the 12th Imam. And now at this point in time, who is there to guide the community aright, to set it on the evolutionary track, to allow it to realize itself? Given when the Prophet was here, Ali ibn Abi Talib salamullah alayhi was here, when the 11 Imams after Ali salamullah alayhim ajma'in were physically here, they were providing us a befitting evolutionary expression to the horizontal relation in order to acquire the vertical one. And we will prove that with example tomorrow, but for today we can see a glimpse of it within the Quran and the conduct of the Prophet. The Quran has abrogations everywhere within itself. The meaning of abrogation in itself shows that the community outgrows a particular expression and that expression is replaced by another expression altogether. I personally never have believed, and with evidence, that any verse can be righteously abrogated. It's never the case. Every verse is eternal. But for our consumption at this point in the evolutionary trend, yes, abrogation has occurred, and it is there within the Quran. When one law surpasses another law and nullifies it in the physical sense, this in itself shows evolution within the Quran. Two, the prophetic community, when he came to Medina, when they were being attacked, accused, mocked at, the Prophet is commanded within the Quran to persevere, to turn a deaf ear, to turn the other cheek. The Madinese community arrives at a point of strength. Now the Prophet is being told that stand your ground and respond to these claims that are being made against you and to these attacks, and prove yourself with audacity. On the one hand, he is being told to turn towards Baytul Muqaddas, and then when the time comes when he has to stand his ground, immediately the command comes, turn your face away from Baytul Muqaddas, turn it into holds of here, hereafter, everything else that me and you know is an expression of the ideal state of Islam and the ideal state of Deen. It has to be fashioned and refashioned. If that is the case, then what is the true state of Islam as we have been talking? It is quite simple, and the Quran has been quite explicit about this. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was introduced to the community, He did not say, I am Allah as opposed to God or Jehovah or Bhagwan or Lat or Uzza. He said, I am Allah. He said, He is Allah, Wahidul Qahar, the one, the overpowering, the only. He never introduces Himself as the other. When He introduces Islam, in the Quran and the verses that we have read, he has always introduced himself, his Islam, as the one deen only that has acquired different expressions. There is nothing but Islam, just as there is nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only distinction that we have been making was a state of godliness and godlessness, or a state in which a person falls within the folds of friend of God or the enemy of God. And that too can be seen in the lifetime of the Prophet. And maybe it's worthwhile mentioning this as we go into our talk for today. That when the Prophet was going into Makkah, the Meccans wrote to the Prophet and they said, offer us amnesty and protection like you did to the people of the book. The Prophet said, they are the people of the book, you are not. Now look at this scenario. The Meccans, a lot of them were claiming themselves to be Hanafis. Hanafi on the deen of Ibrahim salamullah alayhi. A lot of them were claiming this. The Meccans wrote back to the Prophet and they said, you say this statement, but you contradict your own self by giving the Majus the status within Islam, by giving them a status within your religion. The Prophet responds, this is a hadith of Imam Sadiq salamullah alayhi that Bahrani has quoted in Al-Burhan. The Prophet responded, he said, the Majus, even though they might be idolaters, there you go, they might be idolaters, they might be worshipping fire, they might be worshipping the stars, and they are not worshipping Allah, but in essence they are monotheistic. So now the Meccans could have said, in essence we are monotheistic. They did not respond as such. The problem was that the distinction was quite different from the one we understand. The Meccans did not uphold human values. They did not direct themselves in a wholesome way to Allah as the point of self-realization. It was a system of arrogance, it was an egocentric system, and in which there was no human value. Social norms were exploitive. They were exploiting the weak and the poor, and that is what made them into the enemy of God. So in contrast with that, the greater Islam is everything that is directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the horizontal relation of the deen is intact. If that is understood, then the real estate of Islam is one that is dynamic as the evolving human community. It is always moving, it is fashioning and refashioning itself all the time. It is not something that has stagnated at the occultation of the 12th Imam, nor something that came to a halt with the death of the Prophet. The aspect of wilaya gives us ample examples about this dynamism, that there is a core there is an essence there that is always fashioned and refashioned. And inshallah tomorrow when we look at the lifetimes of the Imams, you will see what they were doing. In everything that we can understand to be Islam, they have touched upon it. They saw the need of the community to be united. So Sadiq declared Salamullah Alayh to do one Eid, a global Eid. Look at the literature from Imam Sadiq Salamullah Alayh. When it came to Makkah and slaughtering the meat in Mina, he said, there is so much meat here, take it out of Mina to serve the need. He was saying there is an essence to everything that we are doing. A fashion was given to it, an expression was given to it at the time of the Prophet. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, and he's explicit in using those words, that my grandfathers used to do this. Now the situation has changed, and therefore I am going to suggest this. He was refashioning every single thing that we can understand, but it needs a reader that can understand what he is trying to do. So now, the deen's ideal state has to be one in which the deen is as dynamic as the growing human community, where the deen allows for expression and reformulation of its own tenets, for its own salient features, in order to allow the community to grow. The only thing I am saying here is that a single human individual can never occupy the seat of an imam. The wilaya at this point is a collective wilaya with the human intellect coming together. If this is not understood and if this is very, very ambiguous at this point, then wait until tomorrow and we will explain this issue. But for today, we'll just give an example. If you look at medical ethics and if you look at the whole issue of euthanasia, you will be forced into admitting that a Muslim practitioner of law operating within the pedantic system of literal appreciation of the text can never ever come out with an accurate understanding of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands as the right and wrong of killing and living. What is the definition of death? What is the purpose of suffering? What is the meaning of care? What are all these things? You need philosophers, ethicians, care people from the care establishment, so on and so forth, to all converge together in order to give a proper befitting response. Now here, when we look at the expression of wilaya in the initial days, my God, we ask, I forgive the Sunni community. I really forgive them. Of course, the Sunni intellectuals also blame the Sahaba for not giving Imam Ali his right. The Sunni intellectuals all say that the Khalaf, that the Sahaba made a very wrong decision in doing that. But then, when it came to Imam Bakr salamullah alayhi, he stated they did wrong by taking Ali's right away from Ali, which would have been good for the community, but nonetheless we commend them for the good that they did. But I do hold the Shia community, the people who call themselves Shia, responsible for their stagnation and not adhering to what the wilaya scheme had taught them. If you look at the theology of Ali ibn Abi Talib, it's amazing, it's brilliant. I saw a debate that was going on at Green Lane, Poisoned Hearts. Of course, according to them, the Poisoned Hearts were Shias. And I asked somebody to ask them that let us have our representation. At least let one of those people who you are attacking represent themselves. They didn't allow it according to what news I got. Now, they were leveling all charges against the madhab of Shia. Whereas none of them are true. None of them were true. It's only, they were saying that the Shias talk about anthropomorphism, that God has body. It was Ali ibn Abi Talib who taught us that لا يُعَيِّن بِعَيْن وَلَا يُكَيِّف بِكَيْف. You can't point at him and you can't say what state he is in. He sees but without any eyes, he hears but without any ears. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing like him. The way he explained God is unlike any other system within Islam. When we look at Ali ibn Abi Talib, you look at the cosmology that he gives. This is how the universe is. This is where your place is. This is where you're evolving to. Look at the politics of Ali. Look at the ethics of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Look at the sociology of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Look at his eloquency. Look at his morality. Look at him in every aspect. And if he is not enough, look at the spirituality of Zainul Abidin. If he is not enough, look at the evolutionary scheme, the legal scheme, the legal system in an evolutionary scheme of Imam Muhammad Bakir and Imam Jafar Sadiq. Look at the political participation of the 8th Imam. What doesn't this community have to bring about a dynamic state of Islam that allows for growth and rids all forms of stagnation? The way these awliya of Allah fashioned Islam was that they allowed the human being to grow in the rightest sense. One of the central tenets of deen should be that it allows for growth, self-realization, and intellectual evolution of the community by bringing about the right climate and situation. Now on this note, I would like to say this, that the rightest religion has to be the broadest of religions. Yesterday we spoke about exclusivism, inclusivism and pluralism, and we stated that pluralism does not sit well with this scheme. The greater Islam is inclusivist. It includes the minor Islam, Judaism, Christianity, and every other religion that we have. The broadest expression of Islam is the most accurate of it. I'll give a little example. It might seem a little bit mundane. But once upon a time, and I'm not saying this community is still like this, once upon a time, the Bohra community used to curse and swear at the Shia Imamiyah. Yes? The Shia Imamiyah. But when their relatives would die, they would come and use our facilities. Now we knew, they were swearing at us and cursing at us. The reason why we allowed them to use our facility was because we had confidence in our own righteousness. And since we had confidence in our own righteousness, we were tolerant and our chests were expanded. Can you see that? That is the hallmark of a righteous faith. That is, has so much confidence in itself, in its own righteousness, that it can accept the other, tolerate the other, and give them scope to grow through its own noble example. That is exactly what the Prophet was displaying. That is exactly the Islam of Ali ibn Abi Talib, Al-Hasan, Al-Husayn, Al-Baqir, Al-Sadiq. This was their Islam. Today, the international, today, the British democracy withstands and tolerates the Muslim minority. What does that say about the sentiment of British democratic system, that it is following a greater Islam than these Muslims minority living within it in that aspect of tolerance? It has so much confidence upon its own tenets. It has so much confidence upon its broad scheme that it can allow the minority Muslims who are cursing it to exist within its four walls and to evolve gradually. And indeed, in the last 40 years that I have been here, and you have been here, and some of you have been here, by Allah we have evolved in the way we are thinking. We came to this world considering them najis, this part of the world. We came to this part of the world thinking we could steal from them. We came to this part of the world condemning them to the pits of hell. After 40 years, we have arrived at the notion that they have always been on the Islam that was our human heritage. The best expression of Islam is the most broadest one that can encompass within its fold every other expression. If the Shias today were to understand what they are, they would not call themselves Shia as opposed to Sunni. But unfortunately, the Shias call themselves Shia as opposed to Sunni. Shias would say, we are Muslims as our fathers were, Muhammad and Ali. Can you see this? Today the state of Shia Islam is this, that it has become a reactionary sect altogether. Today Islam has become reactionary. Don't you remember in the early 80s, and some of us were involved in the Muslim parliament, where Marhum Kalim Siddiqui, may Allah bless his soul, he used to head and spearhead the campaign of reacting against the West. Anything that came from the Western mouth was opposed to Islam without it being checked. Forgive me for being so critical about the Muslim parliament in our own history, because I myself have grown with this history and I myself was one of them. There, the whole Islam was reactionary. We are everything other than what comes from the West. Today, Shia Islam has become the reactionary and Sunni Islam has become the reactionary. I am a Sunni, I am a Shia. Who amongst you is a Muslim? Tell me. Who is a Muslim amongst you like Ibrahim was? If you are a Shia, say, Ana Muslimun. I am a Muslim as my Prophet Ibrahim, as my grandfather Muhammad, as my grandfather Ali. Did the Prophet not say, Ana wa Ali Abawa, Ana wa Ali Abawa kulla taqi, Jadda, Ana Jaddu kulla taqi, and Ana wa Ali Abawa hadil Ummah. I am the grandfather of every God-fearing soul, and me and Ali are the fathers of this Ummah. Say, I am a Muslim. And if you want to know what Islam I follow, then I follow the expression of Ali ibn Abi Talib, which is the broadest expression. Look at their attitude, the Prophet and Imam Ali, in that broadness sense. The Prophet was going from Medina to Uhud to receive the oncoming forces from Makkah. The people in Medina dissented. They said, we will not fight alongside you. He is a statesman, the head of a country here. Head of a religion, head of a state. He said, so be it, have your rights. Look at this. Giving liberty to them, bringing about social justice, a balanced life, bringing about a situation when they are evolving and becoming broader beings. In Imam Ali's Khilafah, the Kharijites are being told, dig the trench, mend the roads. They said, we will not do so. People wanted to coerce them. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, leave them. Give them the sort of jobs that they find capable for them, that they are happy with doing. This was the example of Ali ibn Abi Talib. This tolerance, this liberty. In fact, Islam, and I do not like to criticize anybody, but because history is our history, and we have a right to look at history objectively. When Ali ibn Abi Talib sent his tax collector, he said, "Tell them, if you have any due of Allah in your wealth, give it to me. If you don't, I will go back." The first calamity that came into Islam was the sword of Khalid bin Walid, who massacred that community who refused to acknowledge Abu Bakr as a rightful successor to the Rasul, to the Prophet, and he massacred all of them and took taxes from them. That was the first calamity upon Islam. Islam was moving from a point of weakness into the point of strength. Point of strength is tolerance, is plurality, is relativity, is acceptance of the others, is creating a right balance where everybody moves forward. Broadness, strength is not coercion like what happened in the time of Abu Bakr. And then the second Khalifa comes and makes this diwaniya, makes class distinctions within Islam. This was another thing to plague Islam. Then the third Khalifa comes and he overly bestows upon his own family distinction between nepotism. These were things that plagued Islam from the very outset. And hence the wilaya scheme was so important. And then the fourth came, and he waged a war, a second civil war within Islam, which was the greatest calamity upon Islam altogether. That broadness that was created by the Prophet in the wilaya scheme was constricted altogether. And me and you, as a result of that, the Sunnis, the Shias, the Wahhabis, the Brelwis, the Deobandis, the Zaydis, the Ismailis, all of us, what have we become? We have become little groups who identify ourselves through the opposition of the other. This was never ever meant to be the case. Anyone who has awoken to the truth will look at history accurately, will look at human condition accurately, and state that the only befitting deen is one of growth, one that allows self-realization and fulfillment of humanity and the directedness of humanity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the only righteous state for a righteous community to be with. Today, if you look at the Islam given by this wilaya scheme, by the Prophet and his successors, the rightful successors, look at them. Imam Bakir, when he said this, he said, yes, Abu Bakr and Umar did a wrong thing by not giving Ali ibn Abi Talib his right, especially when the Prophet had secured that right for Ali. Prophet did not want to overrule the autonomy of the people. So he said, Alastu awla bikum min anfusikum. Do I not have a priority over you than yourself? When they gave him their rights, that is when he said, then now I appoint Ali, because you have given me your right. Otherwise, it's your discretion, but you have given me your right, yes? And that's why I'm appointing Ali ibn Abi Talib. It was done very democratically. But Imam Bakir said what? But we commend them for the good things that they did. This whole scale opposition, this whole scale warfare, what need is there for this? Yesterday I was looking at Ummah channel, the way they are misquoting the literature which is Shia in Ihtijaj Tabrizi, somebody was reading. But then you look at the Shia channels and the way they display hostility. None of this fits in with the character of the Prophet and the Wilaya at all. None of it. Where is this all coming from? I was in Makkah and I said to the Mawlana, I said, look, separate Maghrib and Isha, Zohar and Asr. We are here to worship Allah. We don't have our businesses to attend to. He said, well, we will pray them together because the others separate them. I said, you want to follow that or you want to follow our noble Prophet? The Prophet prayed prayers separately and the Prophet prayed prayers together. But when you're in Makkah and Medina, do you have your businesses to run? Do you have schools to go to? Pray five times here, you've come for worship here. By priority, pray five times. But no, because the Sunnis pray five times, we will pray three times. Oh man, you are neither a Sunni nor a Shia. Is this not egocentric? If truly we were submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we would follow His scheme, wouldn't we? Ali ibn Abi Talib prayed five times, by and large, prayed three times sometimes. You find Hussein ibn Ali praying five times even on the battlefield. Where have you gone wrong? I will say this, revert to this point again, that there is no individual that can occupy the seat of the wali in the absence of the wali. We want to talk about this thoroughly. It has to be the collective intellect that comes together and moves the community forward. The salient features of the righteous faith is what the wilaya scheme taught us. Now look at us today. Forgive me for stabbing the community like this again and again today. But maybe, who knows when the next opportunity will come, or if there will be an opportunity, who knows who will live for tomorrow. Today, you look at any Shia channel, and I've mentioned this again and again, you see black and you see green and you see matam and you see alam. This is what the rest of the world associates with Shia Islam. Is this all that Shia Islam was? Who can deny the worth of Azadari? Who can deny the worth of this intense love that we have for the Prophet and the family of the Prophet, especially when the Quran says, كُلَّا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. I ask you this intimate love for my near ones, which are Ali and the children of Ali. Who can deny? We will burn for Hussein, we will burn to ashes 1,000 times over. By Allah, I will flee from death. But if it is in the name of Muhammad and the family of Muhammad, I will embrace that with a smile. If it is for them, and embrace it again and again and again. For they have taught me how to live like a free man, and to speak like a free man, and to die like a free man. But tell me, is Ali ibn Abi Talib this? Alam, and Zari, and Matam, is this what Ali ibn Abi Talib is all about? Green, and black, and Marsia, and Noha. Is this what Ali ibn Abi Talib is? Where are the philosophers? Where are the theologians? Where are those great minds that would read his works? Where are the historians that would study his example? Where are the politicians who would give us a sense of Ali's politics? Where are the socialists, sociologists who will look at the text and say, this is an ideal balanced society? Where are those experts of law who will try and understand how he was phrasing and rephrasing the law? Is that all to Ali that we have understood? This community has become a reactionary community. Their brothers Sunni have become reactionary community. In fact, all of them have become reactionary. And the true Islam has been lost. It is no surprise that the hadith says that when Al-Mahdi comes and he brings the Islam, the Muslims will be the first one to reject it. They will say, this is not the Islam that we know. Can you imagine how far away we have drifted from that ideal that was supposed to be there? How far we have drifted away from it? That we will not recognize Islam? The people who will fight the Mahdi will be the ulama of the Ummah. The most learned scholars will be the ones who will deem him to be killed and put to death. Imagine from there how far we have drifted. I'll make this point again and conclude it here, because we want to talk about this great man, the one that we are celebrating and mourning tonight. That the realist explanation of Islam is the broadest of it. Based on that, the expression of Ali ibn Abi Talib should be at the helm of Islam. Where our Sunni brothers, Wahhabi brothers, Shia brothers, Zaydi, Ismaili, Bohra brothers will all say, whatever we are, whatever we are not, but that is the beauty of Islam. Because it is the most inclusive. That is the realest Islam. That is where the expression of Ali ibn Abi Talib belongs. For that is the expression of the Prophet of Islam. It was never meant for us to make Imam Ali salamullah alayhi in the wilaya scheme of Islam as one of the opposing, contending expressions of Islam. It was the original expression of Islam. It wasn't reactionary at all. It understands the meaning of symbolism. It understands the meaning of azadari. And it also understands the meaning of abstractedness and arrival at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without the need of symbolism. It is the finest balance that anyone can bring about in order to allow for human growth. We conclude it. It has to be the broadest expression of Islam that not only the Muslims feel comfortable with, but the non-Muslims also adhere to it. Do you know, when we sit in our interfaith gatherings, we don't talk about commonalities. we only talk about certain spiritual utterances of the fourth Imam, and the rest of the gathering says, yes, this is a commonly shared heritage amongst all of us. That is how broad this scheme is. And that is where it belongs, and that is where it needs to be. What we have done in this day and age is, due to our insecurity, we have become a sect amongst many, many sects. Whereas this is to be the mother of Islam, what we have right now from the wilaya scheme. The point number two is that after the occultation of the 12th Imam, there is a whole process for the community to evolve through trial and error, through experimentation, through their collective wisdom. And no single man can take the post of the wali in the absence of the wali. No single intellect can replace the 12th Imam. I find these claims to be absurd, that one man can claim that this scheme of the law of such and such an individual is the law of God and the Prophet upon the face of this earth. It is utter naivety. It doesn't make sense at all. And maybe I'm being way too ambiguous, but inshallah we will start clarifying it tomorrow. Salawat. If we want to do azadari, then we have to put life into it. There is a lot of value to azadari. Cry, beat your chest, these are human expressions. There is no bid'ah about it. There is no innovation about it. In fact, the Muslim community and the Muslim ummah has totally missed the point when they talk about bid'ah innovation. This is human expression in the evolutionary trend, and we are allowed that. Even if it is formalistically done, it is fine. Do it properly. Put life into it. These people deserve to be mourned upon. This chest deserves to be hit in grief that it feels on Hussein ibn Ali. Even if it's a ritual and a ceremony, uphold it. It has a lot of value. I was in Australia, I believe, when the Iraqis were reading, "Oh Hussein, we will come crawling to you. We will have our hands cut and our feet cut and our head severed for you." And I was having fresh air outside whilst they were chanting all of these things. A very accomplished academician came to me. He said, "Look at them and look at what they are saying. They are saying we will crawl to you and have our arms severed and heads given in your way. Look at what they are saying." And he laughed. I said, "They are better than me and you." I said, "At least they are saying it. Then they will do it. It's closer that they will, because they are saying it, they might end up doing it. But people like me and you who are outside here, who are not even saying it and participating, we would probably and most likely be in the ranks of the enemies of Hussein." And then he felt a sense of embarrassment and he went and rejoined. There is value to it. Don't be naive. As we said, don't be like these who act in reaction. They do matam, it is haram for me. This is not a befitting state. The grief that is there in the love of these masters is such that the hand does strike the chest in grief. That the tears do flood in the eyes. That the heart does tremble. And the heart melts away and breaks into pieces. When Hussein ibn Ali went for his final battle, we find a narration from the seventh Imam that Allah inspired his heart. And he said, "Oh Hussein, look towards the heavens." And he looked towards the heavens. And it was filled with angels carrying weapons to destroy his enemies. "Hussein, take aid of these angels. Destroy your enemies. Save your life. And you will still have the reward I have reserved for you at your martyrdom." The seventh Imam says, his eyes flood with tears. And he said, "Oh Allah, they have killed my Abbas." This was the grief Hussein felt at the death of his Abbas, that he no longer wished to live. When we look at Abbas and we look at the stature of this man, this is what the Imam says about him, As-Sadiq. Abbas, kana kal jabal al-azim. He was like a lofty mountain. Wa qalbuhu ka tawd al-jasim. and his heart was like a momentous wave. لأنه كان فارسا هماما. He was a champion swordsman. وبطلا ضرغاما. A fearless warrior. وكان جسورا. على التعني والضرب في ميدان الكفار والحرب. And he fearlessly advanced into the ranks of the enemy amidst the showering arrows and the striking swords and spears. This Abbas, when we look at his description, it is said that as he was ascend his steed, his feet would touch the earth. Bahrul Ulum was called in to mend the broken grave of Abbas. The builder narrates that Bahrul Ulum asked me to repair it. When I was repairing the grave, I said to Bahrul Ulum, "Forgive me for my audacity if I ask a question." He said, "At ease, O man." He said, "Don't you say that Abbas' stature was so lofty that when he would ascend his steed, his feet would touch the ground?" "Yes, indeed he was such." He said, "O master, then why is his grave so small?" Bahrul Ulum struck his head against the grave of Abbas and cried out, "فَقَطَعُوهُ إِرْبًا إِرْبًا." They cut Abbas into pieces. And this is what we find in the Maqtal, that when his arms were severed, he halted his horse and he just bowed upon the mane of the horse, and they surrounded him and they cut him into pieces. It is said that he did not fall, his pieces descended to the earth. His names are Abu al-Fadl, the father of Fadl; Abu al-Qirba, the father of the water skin, the bearer of the water skin; Abdul Salih, the righteous servant of Allah; Al-Muwasi, the consoler; Al-Fadi, the one who gave his life; Al-Hami, the protector; Al-Waqi, the savior; As-Sai, the one who strove; Qamar Bani Hashim, the radiant moon of the Hashimites; Hamilul Liwa, the bearer of the standard; Babul Hawahij, the door for the granting of every wish; Saqqa, the one who quenches the thirsts. When Abbas was about to come into this world, or before, Ali ibn Abi Talib asked his brother Aqil, who was an expert at genealogy, he said, "Find me a woman that can bear me a brave child." He found Abbas's mother. It is said that when Abbas took birth, Ali ibn Abi Talib carried him in his hands and began to weep and kiss his arms. They said, "Oh Ali, why do you weep at the birth of a child? Rejoice." He said, "By Allah, he will have them cut in the love of Hussein." When Bashir went into Medina and he cried out, "Ya Ahla Yathraba, O the inhabitant of Yathrab, La muqama lakum biha, you have no strength to withstand what I have to say. Indeed, Hussein has been killed." The narration says an old woman appeared and she said, "Silence, O Bashir. This is a false statement." Bashir said, "O maid of Allah, I speak nothing but the truth." She said, "Where was my Abbas? Your Abbas was killed. How can anyone kill my Abbas? O woman, through treachery, they severed his arms." She said, "If they severed his arms, then how did he descend upon the plains of Karbala?" "I will say, Ummul Baneen, ask Zainab, how she descended upon the body of Hussein on the 11th of Muharram." He says, "Wallahi Abbas, by Allah Abbas, if your sword had been in your hand, no one would have reached Hussein, no one would have been able to kill you." His laqab is that he bore the standard. It is the most important position within an army. Ali ibn Abi Talib in Nahjul Balagha gives an eloquent khutbah. "Let the standard bearer be the best amongst you, the strongest, the bravest, the one with most resolve. For when the standard falls, so does the morale of the army. So long as the standard stands, the army stands. And then he instructs the standard bearer, grind your teeth so that when the blow comes upon your face, it slides off your jaw. He talks that the standard bearer should be the pious of all people, the most God-fearing, the one who will give his life for the sake of Allah, but not let the standard drop. Ali ibn Abi Talib was a standard bearer at Badr, and then afterwards at Uhud after many were killed. In Siffin, Muhammad Hanafiya bore the standard after 25 others gave their lives. In Karbala, Abbas bore the standard. But do you know how he bore the standard? Yazid was seated on his throne, and the Ahlul Bayt were brought within the court, and together with them the spoils of war were being brought. The narrator narrates, Yazid looked on, he saw something and he stood in awe. He sat down. He saw it again and he stood in awe. He sat down. He stood for the third time and he asked, whose standard is that? They said, it is Abbas's standard. He said, do you not see this standard? It is severed in every place. Blows have been struck in every place, save the place that was held by the hand. They said, Yazid, that is because the hand was cut first, and then the standard fell. He said, Wallah Abbas, Abayt al-La'an, O Abbas, you refuse to submit. Haqada nusratul akhlaqihi. This is how a brother defends his brother. This was Abbas, and Abbas the way he bore the standard. As far as his bravery is concerned, and his alqab are concerned, Imam Ali at Siffin, when Abbas is only 13, but his stature, he says to his Sahaba, look at the warfare of my Al-Hassan and Al-Hussein. They looked and observed. They said, oh master, if it's not audacious, then may we comment? He said, fine. They said, your Hassan fights gallantly, but your Hussein does not fight. There is a warrior with a face mask that follows him like a shadow, and he does not allow anyone to near him. He said, that is my Abbas, the brother of Hussein. They said, oh Ali, why do you send Abbas and Muhammad ibn Hanafiya to the war front? Why do you not send Al-Hassan al-Hussein? They are the children of Muhammad. These are my children. Al-Hassan al-Hussein are my eyes. Abbas and Muhammad ibn Hanafiya are my hands. And the hands protect the eyes. In Siffin, it was a year-long war. At points, there was ceasefire. At point, there was change in fighting. At a point, they started fighting in mutual combat, one-on-one. Now the way in which Ali ibn Abi Talib would fight would be unique to Ali. Ash'as, a renowned warrior of Sham, he came into the battlefield and he called upon his equal. A horseman came with his face masked. He came to Ash'as and effortlessly struck him and beheaded him. And this was the way in which Ali would kill his opponents. There was a cry in the camp of Muawiyah, this is Ali disguised, approach him not, for no one can withstand the sword of Ali in single combat. As there was this commotion within the ranks of Muawiyah, Ali ibn Abi Talib rode up to this gentleman. From the back he came, and he said, Ana Ali ibn Abi Talib. And as he said, Ana Ali ibn Abi Talib, he placed his hand upon the face mask of Abbas and began to unveil Abbas. And the historians state, it was as if the full moon was brilliantly shining from behind dark clouds. Ana Ali ibn Abi Talib, wahada qamar bani Hashim Abbas. And that is where he gets his laqab, qamar bani Hashim. Abbas's strength, his true strength is not only in his arms, but his true strength is elsewhere. But imagine these arms of Abbas, by God. And I truly believe this, that when Sakina might have heard that she will remain thirsty, she would have wondered with an uncle like Abbas, When Zainab would have heard that your veil will be extracted from your head, she would have thought, with a brother like Abbas. And in fact, the testimonial of this is this, that on the day of Ashura, the historians narrate that Shimr did not smile, but when he heard the jubilant cries arising from Alqama, he asked, what has happened? He was told, Abbas has been put to death. He broke into a smile. He said, now Hussein will not save himself. Now Hussein will die or will submit to Ibn Ziyad. Such was the strength of Abbas, the might of this man. And look at his strength. In the court of, look at his strength in the morning of Ashura. Hussein has had a trench dug behind the tents, filled with firewood and set alight, so that the enemies cannot ambush from the back. Abbas is patrolling the area. Zuhair ibn Qayn comes to Abbas. He looks at Abbas and says, oh Abbas. Abbas says, oh Zuhair, distract me not. It's a sensitive moment. He said, oh Abbas, do you know why your father asked for you? Abbas stood. He said, you've mentioned my father. I have to, in reverence, listen to what you have to say. Speak quickly. Be mindful of the sensitivity of this day. He said, oh Abbas, your father pleaded for you for this day, so that you may save your Hussein. Abbas, in a state of rage, extends his legs within the stirrups of the horse. The horse comes to its knees and says, oh Zuhair, do you wish to incite me? Do you want to see the substance of Abbas? As he said this, somebody cried out, oh Hussein, have you lit the fire of hell for yourself before Allah throws you in the fire of hell? When Abbas heard this, he jumped across the trench and started subduing the enemy. He said the enemy had a spear in his hand. Abbas retrieved the spear with the left hand, put the enemy to death and killed 80 people. He came back and he said, oh Zuhair, never do this to me again. And go about your job, whatever Hussein has designated for you. But the true strength of Abbas, what is the true strength of this man? His control. Look at the way in which this man is. In the court of Walid, Abbas is in a state of rage. His eyes have become red. Sweat is pouring. Hussein places his hand on the chest of Abbas. Calm your soul, O Abbas. And Abbas calms. Again, when the order is given to move the camp of Hussein from Alqama, Abbas says, how dare anyone bruise my brother's tents from Alqama? Hussein calls out, O Abbas, move the tents. He hesitates. Hussein says to Fizza, Hussein says to Zainab, Zainab, call on to Abbas. When he hears that Zainab is calling on to him, we find in the historical books that tears are rolling down his eyes as he is unpinning the tents. But look at the true strength of Abbas. He comes out of the Euphrates. His right arm is cut. And instead of the pain that he feels, he cries out, Wallah law qata'tum yamini, inni abadan uhami and dini. By Allah, even if you were to cut my right arm, I shall never cease to defend my deen and my imam. They cut his left arm. And he cries out, even if they cut your left arm, O soul, do not fear the kuffar and take the glad tidings of the Jabbar. This is the true strength of Abbas ibn Ali. The strength in his character. Abbas, it is said by the Imam, that may Allah bless my uncle Abbas. He gave his life for Hussein, gave his arms, and Allah gave him two wings with which he flies in the paradise with Jafar Tayyar. May Allah have mercy on my Abbas, my uncle Abbas. On the day of Qiyamah, he will have such a lofty rank that every shaheed and every wali shall look upon enviously. We have a narration that on the day of Qiyamah, people shall look at the throne of God and find lights at the summit of the throne, and beyond them will be the most brilliant of lights. They will say, whose lights are these? And it will be told to them, these are the lights of the lovers of Hussein who gave their lives with him on Ashura. They will ask, what is that light that crowns all lights? It will be said, that is the light of Abbas ibn Ali. And look at the love that Fatima has for Abbas. Fazil Darbandi narrates, I saw Fatima in my dream. I said, Salamu alayki. She turned her face. I fell to the ground. And I said, O mother of the Imams, have I grieved your heart? She said, O Fazil, you do not visit my son. I said, O mother of the Imam, I visit Hussein 3 times a day. She said, you visit Hussein, but you visit my Abbas very little. Abbas and his stature. I know my time has gone over, but I will take a few more minutes if that is okay. Abbas is no less than a masoom and an infallible. If you look, when you go for ziyarah of any imam, we don't make mention of any of the sahaba. It is as if when the sun comes out, the stars become hidden. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deliberately planned that Abbas should stay at a distance from Hussein ibn Ali. And when we salute Hussein, we salute Akbar, we salute Asghar, we salute Habib, we salute 72 sahaba of Hussein, but we pray 2 rakat salah is mustahab for the ziyarah of Hussein. But look at the way he has devised it. We will go and do ziyarah of Hussein from one side. This is Imam Sadiq. Pray 2 rakat salah. Come out, go into the shrine of Abbas, salute him from all 4 directions, and then pray salah once again. Such is the lofty stature of Abbas and the way Abbas is. When Zainul Abidin on the 13th comes into Karbala, Bani Asad report that this youth came to us and assisted us in burying the headless bodies. When we brought Hussein's body to him, it was so torn that he asked for a mat. He placed Hussein's body upon a mat and he placed Asghar on the chest of Hussein and buried them together, then placed Akbar at the feet of Hussein and buried the others. As he was burying them, people ran to him and they said, O man, there is a body at the banks of the Euphrates or the Al-Qama that is so torn that it refuses to move. When we lift it by the chest, the feet become pegged. When we lift it by the legs, the back becomes firmly placed upon the dust of Karbala. He cried out and he said, he will not come to me. I will have to go to him. When he arrives at the body of Abbas, he cries out, Wa Abbasa! By your death, the heavens have become illuminated and the earth has become darkened. O Abbas, if only you would have heard the cries of my aunts and your sisters after your death. Abbas is Abbas. I will cut this short now. Abbas, salamullah alayh, comes to Hussein. And he says, O Hussein, allow me to go and give my life for you. Hussein looks at Abbas and he says, Bi nafsi anta ya Abbas. My life be sacrificed for you, O Abbas. O Abbas, if you leave me, the morale of my army will break. Abbas looked at Hussein and said, O brother, what army? There is no one but you and me. O brother, I cannot stand the state of your destitution. Allow me to relieve myself by giving my life. Hussein is hesitating. There are cries emanating from the tents. Hussein said, Oh Abbas, it is as if a child has died. Go and take news. Abbas enters within the tents. What does he find? That little children are dying of thirst. They are crying out for water. And they are rubbing the water skins upon their bellies in order for the coolness of the water skin to relieve them of their thirst. Abbas takes a water skin and says, O children, fear not. I shall bring back some water for you. Abbas comes out of the tents and says, O Hussein, allow me to fetch some water for these thirsty, dying children.
Hussein looks at Abbas, knowing that he will not see his Abbas again. Looks at Abbas and is unable to take his eyes off Abbas. His eyes become tearful. Abbas looks at Hussein, kisses him upon the forehead, and says, "Oh Hussein, I must do this." Then he looks towards the skies and says, "Oh Allah, allow Abbas to bring back a drop of water." Abbas sets off. Hussein waits at the tents. Abbas goes into the Euphrates, cups water in his hand and says, "Ya Nafsu, Ba'd al-Hussein huni." Oh soul, submit to death after Hussein. It does not befit you to live beyond Hussein. Shall you drink of water when your Hussein is surrounded by death? Wallahi, ma hada fi halu dini. By Allah, I shall never do such a thing. Abbas comes out of the Euphrates, makes way towards the tent. Hussein is looking from afar. As Hussein is seeing from the Alkama, the Alam of Abbas, he sees that the Alam is falling. Hussein grabs his back, he sees the Alam lifting. He sees the Alam falling again. Hussein does not know what has happened now. Abbas's arms are cut. Abbas grabs the water skin in his mouth and makes way towards the tent. Two arrows are released. One penetrates the water skin and the other one into Abbas's right eye. When Abbas sees that the water has gone, he stops his horse. As he stops his horse, an iron maze is struck upon the beloved head of Abbas. When the iron maze is struck upon the head of Abbas, he lowers his head upon the mane of the horse and cries out, "Waha! Oh my brother, take my salutations." Now for those of us who have been to Karbala, from the place where his arms were cut to the place where he is buried, there is quite a distance. What happened was that when his arms were cut, they surrounded him and they began to struck him, and they struck him to an extent that finally Abbas's pieces fall to the ground. When finally Abbas is out of sight, Hussein cries out, "Alan, inqata'a dhahri wa qallat hilati." Now my back is broken. Now my means have been severed. Hussein ascends al-Jamal, says, "O faithful, take me to my Abbas. I can no longer see." Hussein's back is broken, is bent. Zuljana moves on, as Bahrul Ulum explains to us. Zuljana stops. Hussein asks, "Oh Zuljana, have you found my Abbas?" Zuljana descends. Hussein descends. He says, "Oh Zuljana, there is no Abbas." Then he looks and he finds the right arm of Abbas. He says, "Wa Abbas, wa akha. Oh Abbas, oh my brother." He cries out for Abbas and crawls where Abbas lay slain. He reaches Abbas, sits next to Abbas. Unable to cry, unable to speak, through the immensity of sorrow, he lifts Abbas's head, places it into his lap. Abbas moves his head away. Abbas is saying something. Hussein draws near to him. Abbas says, "Oh man, allow my brother to come before you behead me." Hussein cries out, "Oh Abbas, it is I, your brother. I have come to receive you." He says, "Oh brother, there is an arrow in one eye and wound in another." Hussein clasps the head of Abbas closely to his chest and begins to cry out aloud. The Maqtal tells us he cried to an extent that every enemy began to cry with Hussein. Hussein said, "Why do you cry now? After depriving of my Abbas, after breaking my back." As Hussein was pleading, he saw tears flooding in Abbas's eyes. He says, "Oh brother, what brings grief to your heart? Abbas said, "Oh brother, oh Hussein, how should I not cry when I find you carrying my head from the dust, when I find you cleansing my wounds, and I know shortly you will be put to death and there will be nobody to lift your head?" I will say, "Oh Abbas, such concern for you, Hussein. Oh Abbas, do you have any final words you want to tell me?" He said, "Oh Hussein, I have nothing to tell you." Hussein tries to lift Abbas. Abbas said, "Oh brother, what is it that you're trying to do?" "Abbas, I must take you back to the tents." He said, "Oh Hussein, I beseech you for Allah, do not take me back. I had promised your Sakina water. I failed her. And if Zainab sees me in this state, her morale will break." Abbas gave a cry and lost his life. Hussein, devastated and broken and defeated, carries the alam of Abbas, ascends his Zuljana. When he goes towards the tent, we find in the Tamaktal that Sakina is running out of the tents, and behind her is Zainab and Kulthub. When they see the alam of Abbas, they come running. When Sakina observes it is her father, she says, "Oh father, do you have any news of my uncle Abbas? He lay slain upon the banks of the Euphrates." When Hussein said this, Zainab said, "Why didn't you bring my Abbas back to me?" He said, "Oh sister, he was mindful of you at his last breath." She slapped her face and cried out, "Wa Abbas, wa qillatana sara wa dayata." My dear Hussein,